Praise the Lord, everyone. I greet you all in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, our soon coming King. Happy to be here in the house of God one more time at our Bible study, where we learn about God and fellowship with each other. We're going to sing page 225, Pass Me Not. Please join me as we sing to the glory of God. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While others thou art calling,
oh, yet
do not pass me by.
My soul, thank you.
will praise you, Lord. With every breath that I take, I will praise you, Lord. This promise I made until eternity ends and start all over again. Even then, I will praise you, Lord. I will praise you, Lord. With every breath that I take, I will praise you, Lord. This promise I made till eternity ends and start all over again. Even then, I will praise you, Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to ask Minister Dixon to come and greet the church.
Praise the Lord, family.
Glory to God.
Just want to greet everybody in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I want to greet Pastor Morris, Sister Morris, and Sister Alicia too as well. And also I just want to just start out in prayer. So if you just pray with me and this time. Father God, we come before you, Lord God, to give thanks to you, Lord Jesus Christ. We worship you, Lord God, in spirit and in truth. For we all know that you are the one and only true God. Thank you, Lord God, for your love and your mercy. Thank you, Lord God, for inviting us into your world, your kingdom, your body, Lord God.
Yes, Lord.
To know you, Lord God. To worship you, Lord God. To see who you really are, Lord God. To see your true nature,
yes,
Lord God.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
To see your true desires, Lord God, for us, Lord God. For your desire is to have mercy upon us and grace, Lord God. To know you, be like you, Lord God. Amen, Lord God. So bless this day, Lord God, so we can know you even more when we open up to your word, Lord God.
Yeah.
Your true and heavenly divine word, Lord God, that is pierced to a man's mind and over consume the man's heart, Lord God. To purge them out of all the iniquity and transgression of their heart and place the true, the pureness that you have designed for us in the beginning. Holiness and righteousness. Let it be so. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise him.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Praise him. And thank him for joy and peace divine. Oh, yes. When I was sad and lonely and didn't know what to do, I thank him for saving my soul. Oh, I say, praise the Lord, praise him. Praise the Lord, praise him. I thank him for joy and peace divine. Oh, yes. When I was sad and lonely and didn't know what to do, I thank him for saving my soul. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Our scripture tonight is taken from Ephesians chapter 6, and we will read from verse 11 to 18, and we will read together. Knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive. Oh, 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Praise the Lord. It ended the reading of God's holy word. At this time, I'll invite Pastor Morris to come. Praise God.
Thank you, Evangelist. God bless you.
God bless.
Amen. It's a pleasure to be in the presence of the Lord another time, to rejoice in his goodness and to honor him for his love and his mercy. Amen. I want to greet, amen, all God's people everywhere. Those of you who are watching at this moment, this video, I want to greet you in the mighty name of Jesus. I want to greet those present with us. Amen. Our dear Minister Dixon. Amen. Sister Alicia. Praise God. And we thank God for my dear wife. Amen. And God is good.
Amen.
Praise him. He is a wonder in our souls. And we thank him for the blessings and the mercy we have obtained through his love. Amen. You know, as I was thinking, as we went through this lesson, my wife and I are taking a course on this Apostolic Bible College. And there's one lesson that stands out. And I just want to take a page out of that. It's a long lesson. And I just want to encourage those of us who are watching here, because these past months have been really trying to so many of us. This pandemic, amen. And it's really understanding that some people are losing their jobs, their lives, amen, their businesses, and even losing their minds. So many people. So there is a tremendous war going on. We're in battle mode. Amen. Battle mode for survival. Because the enemy is on the war path. He is determined to bring destruction to just everyone. Not just God's people, just the whole wide world. It's like he's let loose. But one thing we are aware of is that our God is able to deliver us. He is leading in this fight. Praise God. He is captain of this thing. He is the commander-in-chief. And one great thing we know about him, he has never lost a battle. Praise him. So this fight is on several levels. Praise God. Amen. When you think about it, people are not able to pay their bills. Fight. Amen. We see people just in the house. Sometimes they're just locked up in there for days. And what I've discovered is that they're just not in the house. But some people can go out, but they are intensely fearful of going out as if there's something out there that's going to get them. Yeah, we know that this virus is invisible, so to speak, but it's bringing on a lot of fears. I know this one song which says, we have fightings without and fears within. Amen. So we thank God today that we can look to God, the author and the finisher of our faith. Praise him. And I was also thinking about another song which says, it takes some believing to keep things afloat. Lord knows if you are in this struggle, you are going to have to believe. Because as you notice, if you have these fightings outside, when I look at it, I'm talking about physically outside of your house. Amen. People in the house are just intensely opposed to each other. Divorces are probably on the rise. And you would think that it shouldn't be, because there you're finding we're closer together. We should understand each other and love each other more. But these things are happening. Praise God. But, you know, I was trying to talk to our dear evangelist to remind me of some of the words. So
though
the battle may be rough and the conflict sore,
The rock of the road
as we travel along.
Hold on a little longer.
Yes. Hold on a little longer.
Make Jesus your choice.
Amen. He'll carry you through, right through to the promised land, though the battle may be
rough.
Yes.
And the conflict store.
The rock of the road as we travel along.
Sail on a little longer.
Jesus is your choice. for the promised land. One more time, though the battle may be rough. Yes, though this rough and the battle and the conflict sore. Rocky the road, praise the Lord as we travel along.
Stay on a little
longer, make Jesus your choice, and he'll carry you through. Right through to the promised land. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who is leading in this fight? Jesus. Amen. We have seen him delivering his people. Amen. From day one. Amen. To the present. And it's not anytime soon that he's going to be losing this, or he will never lose it. Praise God. Amen. So, as I say, the battle is on several levels. Praise it. Without, within. Amen. And we have spiritual wickedness in high places. You notice in Romans chapter 7, verse 23, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, and bringing into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members. So you can see the struggles, amen, that we have trying to coordinate things. Amen. Just the mind is just going all kinds of places because of what's happening on the outside. We're trying to settle things. We're trying to develop some confidence in our lives. But when we look, we see walls that are just breaking down around us. Pink slips are handed out. Businesses are closing. Amen. All kinds of things are happening. But we have to stay strong. Strong in the Lord because he is our deliverer. Praise him. And I notice Galatians say, for the flesh lusteth against the spirit. See this? Power struggle. Praise God. Always. And any human being will realize that there is an intense fight going on. The war is on. Praise him. You know, it's not that the devil is going to give up. Amen. Because he thinks he's going to win this. He knows he's defeated. And he says, this, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary, the one to the other. So that he cannot do the will of the Lord. So we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities, against things that are of the world. Amen. And it says Ephesians 6:12. Yes, we wrestle against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. So as members, we are prepared, amen, to observe the command of the Lord. And what is that command? Put on the whole armor. Okay. A lot of times what happens in this warfare is that we fail to put on certain pieces of garment, certain pieces of warfare equipment that is essential for battle. Maybe because we think it is too heavy, maybe because in our minds we think it is not essential. But remember, those who plan the strategies of war, they know that these things are important for our survival and for our winning the war. Praise God.
Yeah.
Amen. And in this, there are certain things that we have to do as children of God. We have to do the natural so that God can do the supernatural in us. Amen. It is incumbent on us to do these things and stand therefore. That is, you can't ask the Lord to stand for you. We have to stand for ourselves because we realize it takes a determination. It takes a willing heart. And it says we wrestle against spiritual wickedness in high places. Amen. So we're wrestling against. We are fighting. We are prepared to struggle against the forces that are out there. Amen. And we are going to withstand in the evil day. And let me tell you, that evil day, in my mind, or I want to put it this way, that evil day is today. That evil day is tomorrow. Because the enemy does not decide that he's not going to attack us today because it's your birthday. Or he's not going to attack you because it's your wedding anniversary. Or he's not going to attack you today because it's your wedding day. And you're all prepped up and prepared to get married and walk down the aisle and say the vows. No, he's not worried about that. He's not going to say, well, I'm not going to attack them because it's their honeymoon. No, no, no. He's not going to say, I'm not going to attack them because, you know, they're just on the job for the first day. He could care less. Amen. But he's out walking to and fro, seeking whom he may what? Devour. So we have to be aware, as Paul said, we have to be aware of the devil's devices. He has all kinds of strategies. But guess what happened? God has given us whatever we need to survive in this battle. And above all things, he says we should pray. Praise him. So it is impossible to fight the spiritual warfare without the rest, the necessary weapons. Praise him. So, and we're going to look at some of these weapons. So, 2 Corinthians 10:3-4 says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh," right? "For the weapons of our warfare are not what? Carnal, but mighty." Mighty not through our supervisor, not through the captain, not through the sergeant, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. There are all kinds of strongholds just building up against us, just trying to force us to quit in this fight. But amen. We have to, as Paul said, fight the good fight of what? Faith. Lay hold upon eternal life. Amen. Because the soldier does not occupy himself with the things of this world. He is called to fight. He is called to prepare for battle. And whenever time comes for him to be deployed, he is ready. Mm-hmm. He is ready. So we have to be ready in this warfare. Put on the whole armor. Notice what he says. That he may be able to stand against what? The wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities. Against powers of darkness, rulers of that. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor. And he's reiterating that. Because sometimes, you know, in certain things, you have to hear this thing over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. Whatever it is, human nature is such that we tend to forget. Amen. Human nature is such that sometimes we want to rebel. Sometimes the soldier goes AWOL. You know, he is fed up of, amen, the discipline. He's fed up of the ration. He's fed up. And it could be some simple things he's fed up with. So he just decides to walk off base or just whatever. But that's not going to work with the sergeant or the ones in charge. They're going to go get him, bring him back, and probably put him in solitary for a while so that he can cool his heel. Amen. God is bringing us into a sense of responsibility, bringing us into understand that this warfare is not an easy one. But the good thing about this warfare is that he actually has done it for us. You know, there's a song that says, "Don't wait until the battle is over, shout now." Praise him. We just have to be there, as I say, do the ordinary, and he will do the extraordinary. We see the apostles when they were going out and really preaching the word. I think of even Peter when he was in jail. Look at him. Herod was about to just knock him off and all that. But he was waiting for a little time. But guess what happened? Angel came and said, "Put on your shoes." You know, angel not going to put on your shoes. Do the normal. And just follow me. Walk and doors just keep opening. He's a deliverer. Amen. It may not be that all times you'll find that. Sometimes you may have some battle scars. But the good thing about it is that you're always winning. Praise God. So in order to prevail against Satan's strategies, we must be sober, as in 1 Peter 5:8 said, "Be vigilant, because your adversary, the enemy, as a roaring lion." See what it is? A roaring lion. "Walketh about seeking who may be what? Devour." Amen. So look, it's not that he is all sympathetic to us. Oh, sweet dear evangelist, look at her. Oh, my God. Oh, dear Sister Morris over there. Oh, strong brother Dixon over there. He could care less what you are. You could have all the offices in the church you want. He is determined to kill. That's what he comes to, steal, kill, and destroy. But our God has given us all the weapons to win in this war. Amen. They are tested, proven. Amen. And it, you know, this is the last one to back us up is prayer. Amen. If you think they see things just falling all around you, prayer, 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 prayer. That will work. That will work. So we stand this attacks in the evil day. Amen. That's in the day of battle. Praise God. The day of calamity. Praise God. And when temptation comes, amen, we can look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of faith. Though the battle may be hard and the conflict sore, hold on, the songwriter said, a little longer. Praise him. So we are given the ammunition to quench the fiery darts of the enemy. You know, he's poised to just, I mean, look at him. We want to protect our loved ones, but he wants to destroy our loved ones. It doesn't matter what you are, the apostle or the bishop or the pastor or the whatever you have office in the church of God. He is determined to bring you down. Amen. But Peter said in 1 Peter 4:12-30, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trials, which is to try you as though some strange things happened to you. So look at it. This is part of the plan. Amen. And once you get these battle scars, you can move on to the next level. War is not some sand thing or some, party. No, it is a serious thing. The enemy is out there to what? Just destroy us. So he has given us the ammunition. Amen. So these arrows, these flaming arrows of Satan, they come to strike us. Amen. To weaken us. No matter what it is, and you can be weakened by maybe a bill. You'd be surprised to know some people can be weakened by just a bill. But it's not just a bill. It could be that you just paid one. Amen. And there's another one, and there's another one. Weakened by word going around that they're going to be laying off a few people. Praise you. The battle is on. But you have to look to Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of your faith. Amen. So he has all kinds of schemes. So when you hear these things, when you think about all this, you can be prepared, what? For battle with, amen, the prayer and the word of God. So he says the helmet of salvation, amen, protect and to secure, amen, these the command center, so to speak, the mind. Praise him. And you know, when we think of people getting hit in the head, that can be very dangerous. You think about these athletes, so many of them get pounded so much in every game. And, you know, after a while, some of them don't even know themselves. They are just like vegetables, so to speak, because their brains are gone. Everything is just mush, so to speak. I mean, I'm not using a scientific term here, but you know what I'm talking about. So the enemy wants to turn our brain into mush. He just wants to destroy us, can't think, can't do anything. And so that's we have to keep our minds stayed on him. Amen. That's important in this relationship with God, because this battle takes a mind to get connected to God. Yeah. Where are you in this fight? Yeah. And this fight does not want people to sit on the back. You can't be a bench warmer in this fight. You can't be a bench warmer in this fight. Praise God. Hallelujah. You have to be ready. Amen. To throw down somebody. Yes, glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. And you know, so as I said, the mind has to be so important to stand up that even 1 Thessalonians 5:8 says, but let us who are of the day be what? Sober. Soberness is contrary, is the opposite of what? Drunkenness. The drunken man, he doesn't know where he is sometimes. He falls asleep on the sidewalk. He's ready. Rain comes, Lord God, when him the snow is there, he doesn't know what's going on. Praise him, the drunken man. Amen. We bless the Lord, bless the Lord, bless the Lord. So we have confidence. Amen. When we are sober, we know what to do. We are alert, mentally alert, prepared for what is out there. God is calling us to stand in this battle. Amen. And as again, I go back to the song. Don't worry, rock of the road. Look, it is important. Look at what Jesus did for us. He showed us that it's going to take a little rough and tumble, but guess what? He has our back, so to speak. Amen, he said. And he said, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth. So this belt is to hold, as it said in this lesson, to bind the flowing garments that will hinder the soldier's movement in battle. You know, we don't wear that now, but there are so many things that come to trip us. Amen. The mind is going several places. Amen. Sometimes we want to just say, I don't think we need to do that. Somebody's telling you, as a child of God, you shouldn't be doing this. And we always have, I don't think we should. Amen. What is better than conforming to the word of God, believing the word of God, deciding that you're going to live a life of soberness and righteousness that reflects godliness? Praise. That's the ultimate objective. And I'm not just saying something to be ostentatious, you know, be showing off. This is not like that. It is a deep, settled desire in us to do the will of God. Amen. In the way we dress, in the way we walk, you know, just our lifestyle is reflective of God's love for us. So that's a battle thing. So the enemy comes, you know, this girdle, you keep your garments from tripping you up. Keep the wrong things from getting in our way. Keep bad thoughts from coming in our head. Focusing on Jesus. Because remember, it's a fight. Yeah. It is a fight. And each of us must win in this fight. Because God has done for us. The Holy Ghost has already won it for us. Mm-hmm. Praise Him. And don't think it's going to end. You find that one day you might fall flat on your face. Look, get up. What the song said, brush yourself off and start all over again. Amen. Because you know what happened? The Lord is interested in our survival. He is interested in bringing us to the end. He is interested in making us win this war, win the battle. He has done it for us. So it is incumbent on each of us too that when we find a soldier falling by the way, amen, we grab him and pull him. Amen. Sometimes it's hard when, you know, the mother in the church or the deacon in the church or the pastor might really, you know, in my days, we'd say rough you up. Nowadays, they want to be so sweet and psychological and stuff like that. But the old days, those older people weren't all worried about nice words. They want to make sure you get up and get running. Praise God. So they might say some things to you that you may not feel good, but, you know, we didn't worry about that because we want to be in the fight. So we are looking to, amen, help each other. Notice that, you know, the military, the Marines, they're not going to leave, amen, the wounded on the battlefield. They're going to drag him to safety, bring him in where he can get help and get patched up and worked up, amen, so he can be back in the fight. This is a fight we are winning and going to win. Amen. So we're going to win against what? False doctrines, against all kinds of demonic forces. Amen. Ideologies of the devil. Praise God. So that again, you have to study the word of God. Know what it is. Because there is the playbook for the athlete. Right? And notice, there's another thing about athletes when I think about it. The coaches don't make near as much money sometimes as some of these star athletes. But it's not like the star athlete can say, well, I'm not going to practice for a couple of weeks. No, no, no. You're going to get just dumped, so to speak. Look, you have to go out, study the strategies, know what's going on. Because guess what happened? The opposing force is also studying your strategy. Mm-hmm. So you have to be able to win. Yeah. So we have to study the word of God. This is our... It's not, I don't want to say playbook. This is a guide. This is the manual that is going to say, don't do this, don't do this, do that, do the other. And we can see, even when we think about faith as another piece of garment, that when we look at the halls of faith, when we look at Hebrews chapter 11, what do we notice? They were doing a lot of things because they believed God. Praise Him. They believed him for what? Deliverance. They believed him because he promised. So notice it. Faith is one thing that we have to have. And notice how adaptable this weapon of truth of faith is. In Hebrews chapter 11, it says, by faith, Enoch was translated. By faith, Noah prepared an ark. Amen. He was doing battle against the forces of evil. God was preparing him, amen, to show that he is a deliverer. And it is faith, because he had never seen rain. He had never done this. God told him to build this. You know one thing about this battle strategy? You have to be connected to God. You have to be able to know when he talks and when to listen and when to act. Because he's talking at us. There's an enemy around the corner that you're going to meet maybe tomorrow or tonight. And this is what you need to do. Amen. You won't say that I've been on that road several times and I don't see anything. No, no. I've been talking to that sister or that brother for years. And no, 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 no. He is putting us on what? Strategizing us to win in this particular situation, putting us on notice that there is an enemy around the corner. It's always there.
Yeah.
The enemy is like darkness. And once light comes in, guess what? The darkness recedes. So we have to be so prepared that God will take us through and instruct us. So here's it. Abraham went out into an inheritance. Look at him. God simply said, just get out there. Go on. Hey, look at him another time. His son. He said, I want you to present this son, you know. Amen. He had faith to believe that God would do something. If he gave it, he can also take it back. But not only that, because he said, through him would the blessing come. This is where this battle was won because of his belief. So faith is imperative in our God. So we have all these. So we have the sword. Look, you are out there in a fighting war. You are out there in a struggle. And you have some tough ammunition, and someone is coming up to you, and you say, oh, that's such a lovely lady. Oh, that's such a handsome young man. I'm not going to do anything. I'm not saying you're going to kill an individual. I'm just saying if you are out there in the real battle, if that's the enemy, and you have that instrument, you are going to use it. So in our case, we're not going to be killing individuals. We are going to be using the sword of the Spirit, the word, amen, to counter the forces of the enemy. And again, I'm saying you have to use the book, amen, putting on the breastplate of righteousness. It says, stand therefore, having on the breastplate of righteousness. So it is, again, to protect our torso, so to speak, because the enemy is coming. He could be coming from your house. He could be coming from the job. He could be coming from even you, your own thoughts. Amen. All these things are there to what? Hinder you, to cause you to want to fail in this battle. So when we put on this breastplate of righteousness, we develop a faith, a relationship with God through faith. Amen. So it is imperative. It says the night is far spent. Romans chapter 13, verse 12. The days at hand. Let us therefore cast out the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Amen. So those who, amen, are of God, we are doing business every day. We can't afford to sleep on the job. You know what happens if you are a guard? And, well, I used to hear the old people tell us about this in World War One, Two, whatever it is. I didn't do any research on it, but I believe them. You are out there as a guard, and you are supposed to be guarding a particular strategic place, and sleep takes you, and you fall asleep. Amen. What happens when the sergeant comes along, or the captain, or whatever it is, he comes along and sees you sleeping? He probably won't let you wake up. Amen. Because you are really a deterrent to good works. You know what could happen in your sleep? Guess what happens? You know it. The enemy will come in and knock off all the people you are supposed to be protecting. So we are also on notice to be alert, to understand the depth of our responsibility as children of God. Praise Him. We are all responsible for one another. In this warfare, look, you see someone doing something wrong, let us encourage that one to shape up. Praise God. And you know, some people might be reluctant. They might try to rebel against it. But your responsibility is to deliver what problems, amen, they may face if they don't take right with what's going on. So we want to do the right thing by believing in God. Amen. As we said, the sword of the Spirit, the word of God. It is a powerful offensive weapon used, amen, at all times to protect us. And notice even Jesus. And when I say even Jesus, I mean that he is a perfect example of what happens. Amen. Look at the enemy. Enemy came on several occasions to do what? Tempt him to thwart the mission of redemption and salvation for us. Amen. So he was alert. What did he say? He went to the well. He went to the word. Amen. It's not like he just said, okay, I don't know. The word said. Amen. The word said. And you notice the enemy had some serious, reasonable temptation. I know you're hungry. Look at it. That's a fact. and you know you can make bread. That's a fact. Why don't you do something about it? Praise God. We see that he would not. Man shall not live by bread alone. The word. So let us study the word. Let us get involved in it. Because these times call for vigilance. These times call for preparation. Amen. To win this warfare. Praise him. And we want to be praying always in the spirit. Military responsibility. Amen. Discipline as prayer. This is important for us. Praise him. And I notice it's after the scripture catalogs our spiritual armor, it calls us to engage in prayer. Prayer is a discipline that exercises the regimen, the perpetual habit of the soldier. Amen. The perpetual habit of the child of God is to be praying. Praying is a connection. Praying is a very important armor. I notice sometimes when you have problems in the household, we have problems with our children, we have problems with our spouses. Amen. You don't want to get into a battle to fight. Amen. You just get on your knees. You ask God to intervene. You ask him to take control. Because in a case that if the wife says, okay, I think we should cook today. And the husband said, no, you should eat out. And then you have fight. If you know a fight is going to ensue, pray. What if you pray? And the Lord will fix it. And that's it. That's like a point. But the point I'm making here is that could be some very simple things, as you know, the old people used to talk about the rat and the mouse situation. Amen. And they get back together, and guess what happened? They said, look at what separated us, a little thing about the rat and the mouse, and they start to fight again, and it's all over. But here we need to look at what it is, the imperatives of the armor. Put on the whole armor. Don't neglect anything. So let's look at it again. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that he may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth. Truth is important. Having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith. Faith is important. Wherewith he shall be able to quench all the fiery darts. And taking the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the what? Word of God. Amen. So then the last one is praying always, all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching whereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. So guess what? Another imperative of this battle is watchfulness. Remember, we talk about the God who is sleeping. It is also important for all of us to be watching. Is that just watching and waiting for the coming of the Lord? Whether you watch or wait, he's coming. We're talking about watching and waiting for the enemy. Amen. And he pounces upon us sometimes in such innocuous ways. You know, it's so simple stuff that you would think it can't be the enemy. And it's big time. It just comes in and it just blows things up. Praise him. So if you want to crush that enemy, anytime he comes in, as soon as he comes in, you can't allow him to expand. You can't allow him to grow. You can't allow anything like that. So, amen, in the family, we need to work on that. Children just getting out of hand. Don't get all upset. Remember, neology. Pray. Pray without ceasing, because prayer works. What are you doing in this battle? Amen. Are you just sitting? Amen. No. You are called to fight. Fight the good fight of faith. Amen. The soldier is called upon to fight. Praise him. I know sometimes when you think about certain contingents that are deployed for war, and you know, families get all upset, why they're sending my loved one over to war. Guess what happened? They signed up for that. Praise God. It started out all harsh to think about it. But that's what they signed up for. You know, the military is not there to just give you an education or to give you some housing allowance or give you free meals or give you dental thing. You know, that's part of it. But the main objective is war, preparation for war. Yeah, I don't know why we're killing one another, so to speak, but that's another political statement. But here I'm saying this particular call to salvation is a call to war. Because you know what happened? Our enemy is real. And there's one thing we know about Satan, he is on his job. Mm-hmm. So we can't be all soft with him. We can't be all fearful. That's the last thing you want to be doing when you are in this battle. Not be fearful, because we have not got the spirit of fear, but of love, power, and of a sound mind. We need these, amen, to stand in this battle. Truly, God has given us what we need to fight. So, my dear friends, let us understand that this warfare is on, and it will be on till the Lord returns. And all of us have a part to play in executing it. All of us have a part to play in winning. Praise Him. You can't depend on your brother to win. We have to put our part in it. You can't depend on your sister to win. We have to be in it. Amen. So we have to get there. Clean your ammunition up. Get in there and pull your weapon down. Clean it out. Amen. Oil it. Get it tuned up for battle. Because guess what happened? When the enemy comes on us, that is not time to go break down your rifle and all that stuff and start cleaning and checking it. You don't want it jam on you. You want it to fire off. Praise Him. So they have, you know, military, I think they just pull down things every now and then. You have the expertise. Amen. I have a dear friend whose father is a police, and she said, as little as she is, I know how to take a gun down and pull it apart and all that good stuff. And I said, but guess what happened? If she can do it, guess what happened? Daddy, who is a police, he knows what he's doing. And can you imagine those big things in the military? They are used, and they have to be really worked on. They have to be all like a well-oiled machine. We as soldiers want to win in this fight. So God bless you. Amen. As we close in the name of the Lord Jesus. So we're going to close with a song as our dear Sister Morris will give us a song as we close. What song is that?
Last Railway to Heaven.
Life is like a mountain railroad.
45.
An engineer that's brave. We must make the run successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch the curves that fills the tunnels. Never falter, never quail. Keep your hand upon the throttle and your eye upon the rail. Blessed Savior, Thou wilt guide us till we reach the blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in Thy praise forevermore. You will roll up grades of trial. You will cross the bridge of strife. See that Christ is your conductor on this lightning train of life. Always mindful of obstruction, do your duty, never fail. Keep your hands upon the throttle and your eye upon the rail. Blessed Savior, Thou wilt guide us till we reach the blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in Thy praise forevermore. You will often find obstructions, look for storms of wind and rain. On a hill or curve or trestle, they will almost ditch your train. Put your trust alone in Jesus. Never falter, never fail. Keep your hand upon the throttle and
and your eye upon the rail. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach the blissful shore. When the angels wait to join us in thy praise forevermore. As you roll up across the trestle, spanning Jordan's swelling tide, you behold the Union Depot into which your train will glide. There you meet the superintendent, God the Father, God the Son, with the hearty joyous plaudit, we repeal the welcome home. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach the blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in thy praise forevermore. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach the blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in thy praise forevermore.
Most generous and eternal Father God,
hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus, for this opportunity to be in your house, dear God, to listen to you and to magnify your name, dear Jesus. Thank you for the word that was ministered to us, dear God. Thank you for the shepherd, dear Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for everything that you have done for us, dear God. Thank you, Jesus, for feeding our spirit, dear God, so we can be a light out there in a dark world, dear Jesus. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for everything that you have done for us. We pray for our individual families and our friends, dear God. Remember, dear Jesus, allow us to remember that you are always with us if we only put on the full armor of God, that we'll be able to stand, dear God. Thank you, Jesus, for that, providing the full armor, dear Jesus, so we have no excuse, dear God. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for everything. We give you thanks, we give you praise. In your name I pray. Lord is my shepherd, and shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures, leadeth me beside the still waters. He restored my soul. You leadeth me in the path of righteousness, for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table for me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.